Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 14 through 18. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit that you received brought about your adoption to sonship, and by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. This is the word of the Lord.
Billy Graham walks into a bar, and he walks up to a man and he says, "Sir, do you want to go to heaven?" The man says, "I sure do." And Billy Graham says, "Then go stand by the wall." He walks up to a second man and says, "Sir, do you want to go to heaven?" And the man goes, "Of course I want to go to heaven." He says, "Well, go stand over there by the wall." He walks over to a third man and he says, "Sir, do you want to go to heaven?" And the man says, "No, I really don't." And Billy Graham says, "Sir, you don't want to go to heaven when you die?" And the man says, "Well, of course I want to go to heaven when I die. I thought you were getting up a bus to go now." People make two basic mistakes in life. One mistake is to think that this life is nothing but gloom and doom, and that bad things happen so much in this life that the only thing we have to look forward to is one day going to heaven. The second mistake that some people make, or many people make, is to think that this life is all that there is, that you live and then you die and it is over. A good biblical view of life is what the Apostle Paul says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. "For to me to live is Christ, to die is gain." That kind of view of life is based on a good understanding of the three eternal values that the Apostle Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, faith, hope, and love. If you read this entire section of Romans chapter 8, we only read a short part of this section this morning, but if you read the entire section, you will discover that hope is a very prominent theme. In fact, the word hope is going to be used 6 times in the following verses. In our modern day usage of the word hope, we use it as wishful thinking. I hope I win the lottery. I hope life gets back to normal when this COVID-19 crisis is over. Or even someone might say, I hope I go to heaven someday. The word hope in the Bible is not wishful thinking. It is an assurance of something yet to come. Some Bible scholars define it as confident expectation. Take that understanding of hope and now make the statement, I hope I go to heaven. I have a confident expectation that I am going to heaven because I have put my faith in Jesus Christ and I know that he loves me. Hope is the assurance of something yet to come. It is a confident expectation. And what that means is that I can live my life right now in this present moment with the assurance that God has the future under control. It's no secret, I love movies. But I have no interest in watching a movie unless it has a happy ending. If I am going to withdraw from the world for 2 hours and enter into some kind of fantasy world, I want to come out of that experience feeling good. I thought the movie 1917 was an absolutely phenomenally well-made movie, but I didn't like it. I didn't like it because it had such a tragic ending. The message of the movie at the end was, There is no hope. We simply lived today so that we can die tomorrow. On this Memorial Day weekend, they will be showing a number of military battle kinds of movies. One of those movies will be Midway. They show it every year, and I've seen it a number of times. It is an unbelievably, incredibly good movie. And what I really like about that movie is at the end, despite all of the tragedy and all of the loss of life, because it's based on a true story and very factual in how they present the facts, despite the fact of all of the tragedy, it has a happy message, a message of hope and encouragement. That those who have sacrificed their lives did it because they had hope that they could help make the world a better place where tyranny and oppression will not be tolerated. I confess that when I watch movies at home, sometimes I cheat. I go to the internet and I look up the ending of the movie before it's over to see how it ends. If it has a happy ending, then I continue to watch that movie, and if it doesn't, I will usually turn it off. And I do the same thing with various documentaries. If I watch Dateline, for example, and there's a heinous crime that was committed, and I think that this person might get off, I'll go to the internet and look up how the trial came out and whether or not this person was acquitted or convicted. If that person was let go and I'm convinced that he or she is guilty, I turn it off because I want a happy ending. I've read the entire book of Revelation. The entire book of Revelation tells us a lot about the future, about the new heaven and the new earth. I don't want to spoil the ending, but I think it's fair for me to tell you that in the end, God wins, the devil loses. We have this hope, this confident expectation, this assurance of something that is yet to come. Going back to our scripture reading, after we are told in our scripture reading that we are the heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, which means that we will inherit the new heaven and the new earth, and that we have the riches of His glory, according to Paul in Ephesians. In verse 18, the Apostle Paul then says, "I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us," or some versions will say, "to us." That word present is the translation of the Greek word kairos. Kairos doesn't refer to minutes or seconds or hours, but rather to a period of time with no consideration for how long it takes. It is a season of time. It is sometimes translated as an opportunity. Because kairos is when everything comes to a head requiring decisive action. That makes it an opportunity. Tying this into last week's sermon, kairos is an opportunity to change for the better. This present COVID-19 crisis is an opportunity to change for the better because we know how it is ultimately going to end. We have hope that God is still in control. One of my favorite books in the Old Testament is the book of Esther. The book of Esther is one of two books in the Old Testament that never mentions God directly. But even though God is not mentioned directly anywhere in the book, He is present throughout the book. The book of Esther focuses on a very evil man by the name of Haman. Haman hates the Jewish people and wants to have them annihilated. And so he devises this plan and he gets the king to sign it into law to annihilate all of the Jewish people in the kingdom. What Haman doesn't know is that the queen happens to be Jewish. The queen, her name is Esther, is the adopted orphaned cousin of Mordecai, another key person in the book. Mordecai finds out about the plan of Haman. And even though Esther has not revealed her nationality, her ethnic background to anyone, Mordecai contacts her and says, you have to go to see the king. You have to convince the king to reverse this edict that he has made that calls for the annihilation of the Jewish people. Esther explains to Mordecai that she can't do that. She can't do it because no one can go into the presence of the king unless that person is summoned into the king's presence. If she goes into the king's presence and he happens to be in a bad mood, she could be put to death. The only way she can survive going into her presence without being summoned is if he holds out the golden scepter. If he holds out that scepter, then that means he is receiving her into his presence, and she is not to be put to death. She is going to have to take a risk if she is going to save the Jewish people. Mordecai says to Esther, if you remain silent at this time and you don't act, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place, obviously putting his faith in God, but you and your father's family will perish. And who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. Speaking of time, when I went to visit my daughter in California back in August, she took me to a place called the Magic Castle. You go to the Magic Castle and you enjoy a wonderful dinner, and then after dinner you can go and visit various magic shows. My favorite magic show of the evening was a magician who was talking about the concept of time. And as part of his presentation, he held up an hourglass. And he talked about how time is moving forward all the time, which it is. But he said at times, time feels like it is standing still. There are other times when time seems to be moving quite normally. There are other times when time feels like it is flying by at a rapid pace. But time is always moving. It's always moving forward at a set pace, even though it feels like it's either standing still, or sometimes it even feels like it is running out. Time is very interesting because we all have the same amount of time. We don't always have the same amount of opportunities, but we do have the same amount of time. Every person has 24 hours in a day. Every person has 1,440 minutes in a day. Every person has 86,400 seconds in a day. We just don't have the same opportunities. We are all now in this season of COVID-19, but we have different opportunities to respond. Opportunities to make the world a better place. Opportunities to touch a life with love, grace, and mercy. Opportunities to lead someone who is lost to an understanding of salvation, or someone who is living in fear to a confidence that God is still in control. We know how everything is going to end. We are the heirs of the promises of God. We are His children. We are the children of the King. Mordecai's question wasn't just for Esther, but it was also for us. That question is, and who knows, but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. The devil went to God a few weeks ago, and the devil was gloating. And he said to God, I have closed the churches of America. To which God smiled and said, I have opened thousands more churches in the homes of my people. We have been using these videos for a number of weeks to communicate the Word of God to families in our own church, in our community, and to families around the country. We get word back from others who have seen the videos and have been blessed by them. We hope that we can continue to do this even after churches start to reopen, which churches are now talking about doing that. Some of the churches in our community are looking forward to June and starting to reopen. We're having that conversation here at our church about reopening our church as well sometime in the month of June. We don't have a date. We don't have a definite plan. We're in the process of coming up with a plan. But in a meeting I had this past week with the pastors of our area where we were talking about reopening churches and what our plans were, one pastor said something that I thought was very insightful. He said, until we realize that we can do our ministry better by meeting together, we are going to continue to do our services online. Because these online services have extended far beyond the walls of our church. These online services have been able to touch people's lives in a way that we couldn't do before this current crisis or before this current opportunity. This season of time is an opportunity for us to find new ways to share the love, the grace, and the mercy of Jesus Christ, which our church is doing via the videos. It is a wonderful opportunity that God has given. He has given us this technology, and He has given us members of our church who are able to put this technology together, to put it online, to use it for the glory of God. May all of us be challenged by the Word of God. Have that confidence and that assurance that God is working all things out according to His plan, and that we have this opportunity in the here and the now to share His love, to share His grace, and to share His message that Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which is lost. Amen and amen.
Good morning, friends. I'm coming to you this morning on location at the Summit Church Cemetery, and it is just beautiful this morning. Can you hear the birds singing? Let's see if we can listen and hear. Yes, the birds are singing their praises to God as well. Well, you may wonder, why am I sitting here in the cemetery? Well, today, or this weekend, we celebrate a very special day. Do you know what that day is? That's right, it's Memorial Day. And it's a day that we remember and we honor the men and women who died in military service fighting for the cause of freedom. Well, we have a lot of freedoms in this country, although right now it may not seem like we do, but we do have the freedom. We have the freedom to worship any way that we want. We have the freedom to go where we want. We have the freedom to grow up to be what we want to be. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute, all the different freedoms that we have, but those freedoms that we have didn't come free. They were paid for with a price. And for some people, that price was their very lives. And those are the people that we remember and we honor this weekend. And so if you come here to the cemetery, you will see that there are flags all through the cemetery. Now, some of those flags are for our veterans who have died, but they didn't die while they were in a war. On Memorial Day, we celebrate and remember the people who actually died during fighting of a war. And so you'll have to look closely here in the cemetery to find some of those people. But there are those people here in this cemetery. So when you come here to the cemetery, and I hope that you do, take a look around and you'll be able to see not only those who died in service to their country, but those who served in some war, whether it be World War I or II, even the Civil War. We know that there are people in this cemetery that served in the Civil War. And so we are thankful for them and for the sacrifice that they gave of giving up a portion of their life, and then for some of them that they gave up their lives. They died for the freedoms that we enjoy in this country. But there was someone else who died for our freedom, and that's Jesus. Because we know that we all owe a penalty for our sins, the things that we do wrong. And yet Jesus died to pay for the penalty of our sin, the penalty that we would be separated from God. But Jesus loves us so much that he died. He gave up his life. He sacrificed his life so that we can live forever with him. He died to pay the penalty for the things that we do wrong. Jesus paid the sacrifice of his life so that we can live. So there's freedoms that we enjoy because men and women died for those freedoms. And then there's the greatest freedom that we have, the freedom from the penalty of sin, because Jesus died on the cross and then rose again, that we would live forever with him. Now remember I said how we have freedoms in this country, and it may seem like we don't have some of those freedoms right now, but I think it's interesting that in God's word, both Jesus and the Apostle Paul maybe spoke about some of those things. In Matthew, Jesus said to us to do to others as you would have them do to you. And so Jesus says for us to treat others as we would want to be treated. And then in Philippians, the Apostle Paul said that we were to look out for not just our own interests, but for the interests of others. And that means that sometimes we, maybe for a short period of time, give up a certain right or freedom that we have in order for someone else to be taken care of. Or just kind of a very simple one is that maybe you know, we have the freedom to be first in line, but sometimes we give up that freedom to be always first to let someone else go first. When we go hiking out in Colorado, there are a lot of trails, and we have the freedom really to go wherever we want, but sometimes the National Park Service puts up barricades in front of some of the trails. Well, we could say, I have the freedom to go where I want. But the National Park Service says, but it's not safe for you to go there. And so they block it off. And so we have to give up that particular freedom to stay safe. We also maybe it's that you're better at something than someone else. Maybe you are a better skier than someone else and you can do the hard ski runs, but you have a friend with you that is just learning how to ski. And so if you take them on a really hard trail because that's something that you can do and you have the freedom to go there, but it wouldn't be safe for your friend to go there yet because they haven't learned as much as you have. So sometimes we give up our freedom for a short period of time to help someone else. And so in this time where it seems like we don't have some of our freedoms, maybe that's a way that we can remember it, that we're serving other people by giving up for a period of time something that we could normally do, but we're choosing not to do it in order to help other people. So on this Memorial Day, let's remember and be thankful for the people that gave their lives, that we have so many freedoms in this world, in this country especially. And let's be thankful too to God that Jesus died so that we could be free from the penalty of sin and death. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for being here in this place that we can remember those who died so that we could be free to do all sorts of things in this country. And Father, I thank you sitting in this place listening to the birds sing, that we have the freedom as well from the penalty of sin because Jesus died and rose again so that we can live forever with you. So thank you for your love for us. And thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice for us. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, thanks, friends, for coming to join me this morning out here in the cemetery. And I hope that you and your family will come and spend some time here and look around and thank God for the people that have come before us to sacrifice for our freedoms. I'm gonna sit here for a while and just kind of thank God and think about those people. But you have a great week. We'll see you later. Bye.
More than life. till all success be done.